Welcome to Pharmaceutical Calculations, a Conceptual Approach, Lesson 37, IV Infusion Flow Rates. Today's objectives are to go through all the parameters that can affect calculations related to the preparation of parenteral solutions for IV infusion, and ultimately, learn how to calculate IV infusion flow rates in units of volume or drops per unit time. Now, as we have seen in briefly, of course, in lesson 35, intravenous infusion allows direct administration of drugs into the bloodstream. And because it bypasses absorption, intravenous infusion of drugs at a constant rate permits precise control of their plasma concentration. Essentially, what we mean over here is that it has zero fluctuation, no fluctuation at all. Remember the lecture about fluctuation and accumulation, right? So that makes intravenous infusion the method of choice for drugs with narrow therapeutic index. And we're gonna see a figure in a minute. Now, this last bullet point is very, very important. So an additional advantage of the intravenous infusion is that drugs can be given with IV fluids such as electrolytes and nutrients, okay? So this is very, very important. Not only you can administer the drug, but in the same IV bag, you could have nutrients and electrolytes. So let us now see the zero fluctuation as I mentioned before. So here, where we have the lower boundary here is the mean effective concentration, and the higher boundary is the mean toxic concentration. This is the IV infusion, as you can see with the green continuous line. So this is IV infusion, constant rate. You see that there is absolutely no fluctuation. So I'm just going to write it here, no fluctuation at all. So that's why it is the method of choice for drugs with a very narrow therapeutic index. And like that, if you administer your drug by an IV bolus at multiple time intervals, and in this case, the time interval is 8 hours, you can see that you have this fluctuation. And in this case, the dosage calculations adjusted the levels, the plasma drug levels within the therapeutic range. But in this case here where the drug was given, let's see, every 8 hours, we have exceeded the therapeutic range and some time intervals is below the mean effective concentration. And when administered every 24 hours, it's even worse, right? Of course, the idea here is that you have to adjust your calculations such that no matter what is the dosing interval, the plasma drug concentration is within therapeutic range. But my point is here is that the IV infusion as it is drawn here hopefully convinces you, hopefully is clear, which I believe it is, there is zero fluctuation and it is the method of choice for drugs that they have a very narrow therapeutic index. In fact, the IV infusion is the most common method of drug administration in the clinic, of course, okay? Now, of course, never forget to adjust the osmolarity of IV fluids. That's very important. And we have dedicated tremendous amount of time to demonstrate how we adjust osmolarity of IV fluids to match the physiological osmolarity. Now, of course, the emphasis here is preparation of IV infusate and flow rate calculations. Now, I have to tell you that we haven't discussed how to calculate the dose or rate of drug administration by an IV infusion. Of course, there are very handy equations, very accurate actually, but that is a topic for the course of pharmacokinetics. Okay, so let us now discuss some of the IV infusion accessories. So solutions for IV infusion are usually stored in plastic flexible bags, although fat emulsions or lipids, because of their affinity to the plastic polymers, they are usually stored in glass containers. Now, the IV bags come in various sizes, most commonly between 50 ml to 1 liter volume capacity. Now let's take a look of a schematic with the basic intravenous infusion setting, although some of you may be very familiar. So here we have the primary infusion bag, whereas this one is called piggyback, and it's a secondary infusion bag. Now the this one is the macro or micro drip tubing. Okay, so their calibration is drops per minute, let's say, they can deliver different number of drops per minute. This is the roller type flow control clamp. And of course, this is the primary infusion line, this is the secondary infusion line, and you can adjust the infusion of the drug in the piggyback to be very different from the primary infusion line, okay? All right, and of course here is the Y-type connector and here patient's veins, all right? Now, the primary infusion bag contains the main fluid for patient's therapy. Drugs could be added in the primary IV bag at any time during the infusion process, or they could be administered from a separate IV bag, which is called piggyback, usually smaller volume, into the primary infusion line. As I just mentioned, the piggyback method has the advantage of administering the drug at a much faster or slower rate. Now, the flow rate of primary and secondary infuse aid is manually adjusted with the aid of a screw or a roller type clamp. So here we have macro and micro drip tubings. The macro drip tubing delivers 10 to 20 drops per ml, whereas the micro drip tubing dispenses about 60 drops per ml. Okay, so here now we have example 15.1 to demonstrate exactly how to carry out flow rate calculations. We have a medication author that is asking to infuse 1,750 ml of solution of D5W and 10 milliequivalents potassium chloride per liter at the rate of 125 ml per hour. So obviously here, this 1,750 ml of solution contains both of these at this concentration, okay? And obviously the D5W there is to adjust the osmolarity of the potassium chloride solution, because this is relatively dilute, okay? So how much glucose monohydrate? So obviously the available source of glucose in the clinic is glucose monohydrate, which has a higher molecular weight, as you can see here. So glucose monohydrate has one molecule of water per molecule of glucose. So we need to determine how much glucose monohydrate and potassium chloride are needed to aseptically prepare the above solution. What would be the drops per minute that the infusion set should be adjusted to if the infusion tubing delivers 15 drops per ml, and how long will it take to infuse 1500 ml of the above solution at a given rate? So let's start with the calculations involved in the amount of glucose monohydrate needed to prepare the solution. So here we are. Obviously, since the molecular weight is higher of the glucose monohydrate, it's going to take a little bit bigger amount of glucose monohydrate. So based on the molecular weight, one mole of glucose monohydrate contains 198 grams instead of 180 grams, okay? So all I have to do here is convert 5% glucose to glucose monohydrate. And the way I do that is just divide the molecular weight of glucose monohydrate by the molecular weight of glucose. So 5% glucose, this is weight per volume, obviously, right? Times 198 over 180, that would give me 5.5% weight per volume glucose monohydrate. So now that I have 100 ml, I have 5.5 grams. Now that I need to prepare 1,750 ml, how much glucose monohydrate do I need? And that comes to 96.25 grams of glucose monohydrate. Now for potassium chloride, this is a monovalent salt, right? So KCl in water dissolves into potassium and chloride, and therefore N is equal to 1. Therefore, the equivalent weight is equal to the molecular weight, which is 74.5 grams. So now I'm ready to set up a ratio. 74.5 milligrams of potassium chloride is equivalent to 1 milliequivalent of potassium chloride. I have 10 milliequivalents per liter. So the amount of potassium chloride per liter is 0.7 1,745 grams, but I need 1,750 liters. So totally I need 1.3 grams of KCl. So to prepare this solution, I have to dissolve 1.3 grams of KCl and 96.25 grams of glucose monohydrate and QS to 1,750 ml with water, okay? To calculate the drops per minute, multiply the rate of infusion, so here is the rate of infusion, by the drops per ml. So that's the infusion set, the calibration, right? So ml and ml cancel out, and I have about 31.25 drops per minute. So round it down to 31 drops per minute. Now divide the given volume with the flow rate. So now I have, for the C, right, which was asking how long it takes to infuse 1500 mLs. So divide 1500 mLs over the infusion rate, and it should take 12 hours. As simple as that. So some of the pointers now. So round off the number of drops to the nearest whole number. So that's rule number one. Now, rule number two, and I recommend you, and you're gonna see that you cannot memorize these flow rate equations. I strongly advise you to always write down the corresponding units and use the units to decide which mathematical operation you need to do, division or multiplication. So learn to use the units as a guide for the appropriate mathematical operation and the units of the final answer to verify the correctness of your answer. So please include the units when you carry out calculations of flow rates. This is the only way to make sure that your calculations are correct, because you should end up with the correct units in your final answer, okay? One last notification here. In chapter 10, we have stated that infusion of IV potassium chloride solutions in dextrose should be avoided in the treatment of severe hypokalemia. Obviously here, and we have also mentioned the reason, right? Because of insulin secretion. Now the case it described in 15.1 is of course a very mild hypokalemia, but that doesn't justify obviously the inclusion of dextrose, even if it works. But my point here is that you shouldn't have prepared it in D5W. This is my judgment, but don't be surprised if you see these solutions in hospital protocols, because if they have been using it for so many years and they are working for them, it's very hard to discontinue. So old habits die hard, I guess. This is all I can say here. Okay? So these are practice exercises for you. They are very nice exercises, and you are provided also the answers. So here you need to prepare an IV solution of a drug at a final concentration of 3.84 milligrams per ml in normal saline IV bag and infuse at the rate of that. Enjoy it. And the next one also is a calculation, but here we have a mixture of calculations based on body surface area, okay? But at the end, of course, you're gonna have to calculate the infusion rates. Again, these are very nice problems. So at this point, we have reached the end of our lecture. I would like to thank you for your attention.